Our topic is about digital agility. So we are reflecting the agility in everything that we do, which includes having your lunch on time and speeding it up. So without further ado, I just wanted to kickstart this panel. Our panel is about the need for speed and how do we bring in organizational level digital agility. So I have a really good list of panel members here, and I would like each one of them to give a quick round of introduction about themselves and primarily talk about two things. One is we are talking about Agile and DevOps, and I wanted each one of them to give a small definition of what DevOps means for you, because I believe that all organizations have a different version of DevOps and what they understand of it. So it'll be good if we can start from there. And also in the context of your organization, if you could give some examples where, if you could talk about a pre and post scenario before you implemented digital agility, as we call it, what were the state of things and how did things transform for you in your individual organization? So if you could, Sue, if you could start from your side.
Yes, thanks. My name is Sue McKinney. I recently started up a consulting practice around software development best practices and transformation at scale. I've done some work at Pitney Bowes, helping them scale. Most recently, I was with Veritas as the head of engineering on the data protection side and turned them around as well to be more high-performing and more agile. To me, DevOps and Agile are very complementary. They're about culture and mindset changes, about best practices. One has more tools associated with them, but it's an evolution. And DevOps really has come into the full stream of things because of the digital transformation that's going on. So for all your digital natives, it's just natural to start with a DevOps mindset. If you're in the legacy side of the business, it's a little harder. Because you have a lot of encumbered old technology along with the products potentially. So my two examples would be, I have a product at Veritas that was 25 years old. Builds would take 2 weeks. Had to work on the automation there and doing things like infrastructure as code, trying just to get the concepts of DevOps employed so that we could go faster. And by the time that I got done with that project, which was over 18 months, we got our hardening cycle time, so it's a little waterfallish, from 22 weeks down to 6 weeks with all the automation and introduction of best practices. So that was a good story for our legacy product. On the cloud native side, it was a little easier. You have the tooling in place. It was just incorporating the mindset changes and thinking about continuous integration, continuous deployment. I'm working with a client that deploys 8,000 times a week, and you really have to be careful. And their rollbacks are 1%, and they graciously get through that without being disruptive to their end users. So those are the two things that I would bring forward to the table. So DevOps, agility, or Agile is really a business enabler for business agility.
Thank you, Sue. Surya, you come from CA, and CA does have a lot of solutions which have been there for a long time. And of course, now a lot of the solutions are cloud native, the new age solutions, but you do have a lot of legacy as well. So in the context of your organization, if you could talk about what digital agility means for you, as well as how have you seen things transform at CA, that would be it.
So just to start with background, my name is Surya Panditi. I manage the Agile Management Business Unit at CA. In terms of my personal background, I've worked in large companies, in a company with over 80,000 people, and I worked in a brand new startup that I co-founded. So I've seen the full spectrum. And I thought the answer to your first question, Preeti, was when I took the job to manage the CA India team, I had a very interesting experience. So there was one business unit VP. I met with him, talked about agility, adoption of tools, and we had a very interesting discussion, and he told me, yep, we've gone agile. When I asked him what he meant by that, he said, well, we're doing scrum teams, we're doing stand-ups, we have, he checked each of the various things that are called for in the process. And then I met with a different VP of a BU, and he said, we've gone agile. And when I asked him what that meant, he said, well, We're down from 18 months to 12 months on our way to 6 month release cycles. Our NPS is off the charts. Our capacity, our velocity has increased, so I've got actually 25% more capacity. So a measurement, not of the process, but of the outcome. And I thought that was a very interesting experience for me and something I'd encourage all of you to consider when you're looking at how you adopt tools. Point two about the agility and DevOps, I do see them very linked, though they evolved independently. The fact is, being agile without having the right kind of tool chain for being able to deploy just means you're going to have a mismatch of velocity. And so those have to be very tightly integrated. And then third thing to your question about legacy, I have to share with you the very first group within CA that adopted Agile was the mainframe business. And to fantastic results, business results, not just, hey, we're working faster. It was actually bringing innovation into mainframe. And that I have to give a lot of credit to the GM of that business because he was one of the first people to adopt agility. So I would say that you when you think about putting your customer at the middle of what you're doing and you're very focused on the kind of expectations that they have and meeting those and being able to very quickly iterate and give them what they really are looking for, that's a very powerful tool and you can apply that into what you might consider legacy systems as well.
Sure. Thank you, Surya. I'm going to come back to that example of yours, sure. And we'll deep dive on it a little later. Anjali, over to you. You've been part of, again, you know, large organizations which have had a lot of legacy systems there, and now you're part of another organization, and I think you've gone through multiple cycles of implementing Agile in various organizations and now, again, trying to do that in Rocket. So could you talk a little bit about what agility means for you and your experiences from the past?
So I think I'll start again with my background. So I'm Anjali Arora, I'm the Chief Product Officer for Rocket Software, which means I own all engineering, product management, and strategy for Rocket Software. I've worked at a lot of large companies, including CA, Oracle, and Allscripts, and actually I think I was one of the first ones to adopt Agile at CA. So I think in 2005 or 2004 when Agile was pretty brand new to the industry. And I've done this transformation. Sue and I were talking about this is my third time doing transformation of a big organization, which is waterfall and has a mix of legacy, non-legacy, hosted, and native cloud products because a lot of people mix cloud as being cloud and then they mix Agile and DevOps and cloud. And they are all interrelated, but they are all very complementary to one another. And if you don't adopt all the things in the right manner, you actually cannot get digital agility. Talking about what DevOps means to me, is really making sure that your time to have the customer adopt your product is the least. So it is not about continuous release, it is not about continuous delivery, it is about continuous adoption. So from the time you write code to the time your customer is live in production, to me that is DevOps and Agile together. When you do it right and you automate everything, your customer should be able to adopt and go live without any hitches, without any migration problems, without having to figure out what customizations they need to do. It should just be configurable and they go live without any pains. That's when you've kind of, that's nirvana. That is what you've done. One of the examples I want to give, it is a non-traditional example of Agile, and this is from Oracle. When I was working at Oracle, I ran their life sciences and healthcare division, industry vertical. We had a lot of products which were cloud products, but they were really hosted products. So we had a DevOps team, which used to maintain the infrastructure, right? And they were responsible for doing the installs and the configurations. And then we had the support team, which used to troubleshoot the support tickets coming in from the customers. And then we had the development team, which built the product. Now, the interesting thing was to troubleshoot a ticket of a customer and actually deliver a fix used to take a long time. So we actually adopted Agile across those three functions. So we adopted Agile and we actually went to a Kanban board and we adopted Kanban between the DevOps, which was our cloud team, the support team, and dev team, and we used to manage all the tickets through the support board, which meant they were on a daily stand-up every day. And that meant that our ticket resolution time became so fast, and we used to like measure our escalations, and we used to measure how many escalations per day and per month, and we reduced it by almost 70%. Because it was more collaboration, it was more people talking together. So this is a non-traditional example, because people talk about Agile and DevOps, and they're really talking about the development portion of it and getting it out. They are not sometimes not involving support, and I'm not talking level 3 support, I'm talking level 1 support here. So that is one of my favorite examples.
And that's a great point. Before I come back to you, because I have a follow-up question to that, I just wanted a show of hands in terms of, you know, for all the people who are represented here, how many of your organizations would you truly call as being Agile? Okay. There are a few people there. Great. So I'm going to come back to you, Sue, because we had a catch up before we walked in, and you mentioned about something very interesting. You said it's either DevOps or no ops. Could you talk a little bit about that? What do you mean by DevOps or no ops?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, this space is evolving so quickly now, and I bet if we did a show of hands on how many people are doing pure DevOps, it would be probably pretty low as well. Mm-hmm. But it is really managing the entire life cycle, from the build of the product to managing the product and then running the product. So there's a whole life cycle that DevOps includes. In a nirvana state, and this is what Netflix will debate with other people, is we might be able to get to no ops, which means the code is self-correcting, and that you don't have to have necessarily SREs out there or operators, because the monitoring systems will understand where you're having the bottlenecks and self-correct. I think that's a bit extreme right now, but if you see how well this is evolving with the tool sets and the monitoring tools, and then you add AI or machine learning, you could possibly get to that. Mm-hmm. Not before my lifetime, but I think, you know, you should have an aspirational goal of going to a no ops environment. But I think right now, let's just do DevOps well, and we're still trying to figure out that lifecycle management of DevOps.
Well, it is a very distinct possibility in the future, because we heard Pascal say in the morning that, you know, when they had two machines talking to each other, they developed a new language, mm-hmm. which the humans couldn't understand. So we are getting into a state where, you know, machines could, communicate with each other, self-rectify, and, you know, do things which without much human intervention coming in. So I'm going to go to my next question, and Surya, I would want some viewpoints from you there. We did ask for a show of hands, and agility and DevOps is not something which I think it's not a new word to the industry, but yet we see that the adoption is pretty low. As per industry numbers, the organizations that have truly adopted Agile is less than 6%. So what I really wanted to hear from you are, what do you think are the challenges in adopting and creating a truly Agile and DevOps organization? And not so much for the digital natives, because I think for them, right from the word get-go, they are born in the new environment, so it's probably easier to move faster. But and you mentioned about a mainframe example, so I really wanted you to go back to that example and tell us a little more about how do you enable an organization which is not digitally native, get them on to this journey of going Agile.
Yeah, you know, I think one of the mistakes people make is looking at silos in terms of how they adopt agility. And to me, it's three things. It's the people, and I think, Sue, you talked a little bit about that, which is the mindset, the culture, having the support from the organization all the way up. And important that people really internalize not just what they're doing, but why. What is the expected outcome? The second piece is the process. And process, again, Anjali, you talked a little bit about this, but the process has to be adapted to the specific organization. You can't just bring in a form and say, I'm going to check these boxes, and that's the only thing that means Agile. It has to fit how the company works, what your expectations are for business results. And then the third part is a platform. The platform is important because you have lots of tools that will help you with agility, but most of them are very localized to teams. And so someone might say, oh, I found a pretty cool tool, I searched on the web, I downloaded it, I'm using it, yeah, it's easy to use, I can configure it. But the fact is, when you have team-level tools that don't have the ability to be visible at the enterprise level, Each team is doing its own thing. There's no transparency. There's no real visibility across the entire value stream, which means, yeah, you each one of you may be running fast because you're using this tool, which you know from a company that sells those, versus something that gives you enterprise level agility. So that's why I'm calling it a platform, not just a tool. If you bring these three things together, the people, the process, and the platform, then I think you can actually start to see the results. And if you look at the way our mainframe team adopted agility, it was all those three things. So they went, the support was from the GM of the business unit. He said, we are going to go agile. The processes they followed was adapted to meet their specific requirements. And then they used, we were lucky to have a product in our own portfolio. When we acquired Rally, we got Agile Central. And that's what he used so he could get the transparency, which no other tool would give him. And so when we brought those three things together and said, okay, now let's measure results. And the results were really around quality. It was around innovation. And I really, again, I'm always really impressed that innovation started in this, what people think of as legacy. It was in innovation. And to your point, Anjali, it was about adoption. Yeah. Customers coming in, and he actually had customers coming into the big room planning and participating in those. And very large name customers would come in and say, here's what we're doing and how can you help us? And they would take those practices back. We're talking about companies that are, you know, very large, very traditional, saying we have to adopt agility. So that's really what I walked away with when I saw what the mainframe team was doing.
A quick follow-up to that. Nowadays, a lot of companies talk about agility because they have the fear of disruption, right? And they feel like the newer players are much more nimble and they're getting things faster to their end customers. When somebody is looking at their whole portfolio and looking to see where do they start, how do you go about answering that? Like, what do you start
with? So if I think of the traditional businesses, I was having dinner with a CIO of a very large bank. And we were talking about agility, and she stopped me at one point and said, you know, it's really, here's what I want to do. When a customer or a prospect comes to our application, whether it's on a mobile app or on a laptop, online, I want that person to feel when they're applying for a mortgage that they are getting a very, a fantastic experience. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, my bank or the other bank may have, you know, mortgage rates that are pretty close to each other. We're not going to be hugely different. But buying a house can be very intimidating, and people are already in a place where, you know, they're nervous, they don't want to, they're scared and all that kind of stuff. I want them to come into my app and feel like they are in a comfortable place, they know where they are in the process, and they know what to expect as the outcome. So we started talking about that rather than saying, you know, I'm going to have 8 scrum teams do this, and I'm going to have 10 scrum teams do that, and then I'm going to have So the whole discussion was really around how to get the user experience. So I think to your point, it's focusing on that as a way to start, mm-hmm. and then working your way backwards. And again, the adoption piece, I think, is important. But that's the outcome that people are really looking to do, not necessarily checking the box.
Yeah. Right. If I can just add to that. So one of the things in doing this, I guess, multiple times now, what I've found is, you have, and Surya talked about this, you have to bring your customers along with you, because if I can put a release out every week or every month or every quarter, doesn't matter if they don't adopt it. So it has to start with the customer. So when you choose which product or project or portfolio to start to move towards Agile and DevOps, you have to make sure your customers are with you and they are ready to uptake at the frequency you want to go, and they are getting the results that you want to deliver. Because if you are not aligned on it, the teams get demoralized and they don't want to do it anymore. Because if they put out 15 releases and nobody picks them up, they are going to say, why am I going crazy and why am I doing this? Or if they start building features which nobody uses, same mm-hmm. thing happens. So one of the obstacles to bringing agility is lack of customer adoption or lack of customer buy-in into the process. So you really have to work with your customers and make sure they want it, they will adopt it, and what do they want. And that is a benefit of Agile as well. It is higher customer satisfaction and adoption. So you have to link it that way when you choose what you want to put, take as the first thing and adopt for Agile.
Got it. So I wanted to take your viewpoint on this because mm-hmm. now you work with a spectrum of end customers, right? Where do you see them not being successful in their digital initiatives using Agile?
So it really comes down to culture and mindset. If you cannot get these guys across the finish line, if they don't believe it, they're not going to do it. You're just going to get lip service and you're going to go through the motions. So that's probably the biggest challenge, because it's intimidating if you look at the different roles people play in an agile environment. The role of the manager changes. So now they have to get comfortable with taking a different type of role of empowering and enabling their teams versus being the person that's solving all the problems. And so that becomes uncomfortable. People just get insecure. So where I've seen it work best is, to your point, you get support from the top. They provide the air cover, because it's going to be risky. You start to enable it, get some small wins at the engineering level, and then it becomes very viral. And it feeds off itself, because you see success after success after success, and people are saying, wow, this actually works. And so the fear is gone now, because there's some proof points, and you've given them the right support structure to be successful, that it becomes easier to adopt. But I came into Veritas, and they had tried Agile twice. And it was, they brought a consultant in, I think they brought in McKinsey. They gave them a stack of paper or an article on how to get started, and they left. Well, how is that gonna work? And so they were burned twice. When I came in, there was a lot of fear. And I just had to say, hey, I've done it a couple times now, large transformations. And I said, there's no fear here. There's no one that's going to be penalized. We're going to make some mistakes. I even told my boss that the first 4 or 5 sprints are going to be very ugly. There's not going to be a lot of velocity. But once they get going, it's going to start to pick up. And as soon as that happened, and I told my team, I'll provide the air cover for you, just start. Mm-hmm. Learn by doing. And you get that, and that's how it took off at Veritas.
You know, if I could add to that, so this is a confession. So just to be very clear, I was at a very large company running a $4 billion business. And when I first came across Agile, I said, I know how to build products, guys. I don't need to learn, relearn this thing. And so my initial reaction was resistance, and I'll admit that. But what really changed my mind was, A, talking to customers, and I started realizing that they themselves were looking at things like SDN and the disruptions that were happening in the industry, and we needed to understand that, and again, we had to put them in the center. Second thing, which really opened my eyes, was over 30% of my budget was going into features that were either not being deployed at all or very, very minimally deployed. So we were wasting a ton of money, yeah. And those really opened my eyes, and I became, obviously I embraced it, but I think that's the journey sometimes people have to go through,
yeah.
And realize that there's a better way, and then they start adopting the tools. And again, as I said, it's not just the, it's the people, process, as well as the platform.
It's the combination.
Yeah.
Right.
Sorry.
No, that was a great point. And Anjali, you actually spoke about a very interesting view of agility, which you said that you should reduce the time that it takes for customer adoption.
That's correct.
And when you talk about that, then you're not just talking about agility from an engineering point of view, you're talking about agility in terms of how you manage customer relationships, yeah. How you sell into them, how you manage the marketing around it, the UI, UX, so the whole design experience. So how do you rally an organization and bring together all these various elements of the organization to work together to actually deliver that, when you say reducing the cycle time for customer adoption, how do you reduce that gap?
It takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of patience, and it takes a lot of hard work. What happens is, as Surya said, there is resistance. So I am in an organization right now in my new role. I've been here 4 months. My organization thinks they are agile, but they are, I think, not even semi-agile, right? And the whole organization has to become agile. You can't say R&D will be agile. It is not R&D will be agile. Everybody has to be agile. Marketing has to be agile. Support has to be agile. Services has to be agile. Your CEO has to be agile. You have to think like that. You have to make commitments like that. So what you have to do is you have to actually start from the top, and you have to start getting a buy-in from the top and starting to tell them what are the benefits, and you have to actually show them. And then you start going down. What I found is the engineers are the easiest to convince because they get more empowerment, and they get to do what they like doing, and they get to kind of do it their own way, and they get to say, you know, how much time it will take, because that is the principle of Agile, right? Empower your people, empower the teams. The managers, and the higher the manager, the more concerned they are about bringing Agile in. I think what in the end works is you need a champion, and you need a champion who knows Agile and who knows how to implement it and how to get people to rally behind them. And I guess I have been a champion in most organizations for Agile, and what I found is that a lot of my time goes in convincing people and talking to them about the benefits to them and how it would improve their life or their customers' life, and slowly they come around. But it is really a massive cultural change, and it is not easy. When you bring it in, typically people think they are agile, but to really get agile into an organization is a 2 or 3 year journey. It is a very long journey. And when you add DevOps to it, which requires a lot of tooling and a lot of automation and a lot of collaboration between functions which have never worked before, it makes it even harder.
Right, and I think once you have some customer stories, success stories to tell, then I guess the acceleration is a little faster, because
absolutely,
then you have all the naysayers come onto your
absolutely, side. And the way to start is with the customer. So if you get a customer involved with you, and you start grooming your backlogs with them, you start looking at their problems, and then you start delivering, even if it's a small thing, and it can start with a bug fix, and you do it in an agile manner. Don't try to do, I mean, we have to do the big bang in terms that you have to say we are going to adopt Agile for the organization, but showing small success matters. Mm-hmm. Because the small success leads to the bigger success, and then it's a snowball, and it becomes faster and faster. So pick something small, get a win at it, and then start doing it bigger and bigger. But get the whole executive team behind Agile. You have to start kind of in both places.
Get buy-in. Right. We have a little bit of time to take some questions. So is there any question in the audience? Thank you. This was such an interesting discussion, and I thank each one of my panel members. I'm still sticking to the time.
So thank you.
No, thank you enough. Yeah, just a small token of appreciation.